start these things if this is going right. Now, this is June the 30th, 1975, and we're on James River, just below Owens Bridge, which is just above Owens Ford, and I guess this is Owens Bend. So I'd say your family came here a long time ago, but everything's named that.
Yeah, that's been here. My grandfather, when he come here, land was pretty cheap. I think he only had 40 acres, but he sold for $40, and the man who sold it to him made him 200 posts off of it. Yeah. And the boy, he's in the hospital now with a stroke. But he's raised his family there, and he's abstract, he knows it. And he bought another 20 acres, and about 5 years ago, he went blind and sold it for $28,000. He didn't know how to price it.
Well, where are you born?
Just across the river, just across the river. He bought this on this side when I was just about 9 years old. And I've been here all my life, and I've seen a terrible change. Now, there ain't no if and then. If the change is like it was the last 70 years, or on past 72, I don't know what it would be. Nobody else will. The river is gone.
Yeah.
It's completely gone, and don't let nobody tell you nothing else. The city of Springfield, they can do and prove anything they want to. They, this disposal plant over here, the last fish kill we had, they went to court and proved it runoff killed. They just as well to let it go down the river, right on down the river, but they spread it out there and the rain washes it right in the river. And it's just every day, they say. And it's probably treated, but it ain't saved by a river. Nobody can. And it's the same way right up this fireplace. You go right down there to now and test that water. It was 88 today. And I bet you that water is not too forthcoming. And fish are just like you and me. And it gets up close to 100. If we see a shade and get to it, we're going to go to it. The way the river's been since early last fall, there ought to be a lot of fish up here. For the river has been nearly bank full and above ever since it started breaking. Well, if they're here, I can see it. You go out there, you can hear a bullfrog on it. Used to, before this power plant went in, I'd sit out there this the way would have been, and bullfrogs, they hollered everywhere.
Yeah.
Now you can hear, all you can hear now is racket and somebody shooting.
Yeah.
That's just the way it is.
Well, you hunted bass all your life, man. You just lived on this river all your life, man.
The river has done me a heck of a lot of good. In two or three ways, see, I've done about my fishing. Driving, float trips, and trapping. In other words, I give a little old ground credit for everything I own. Got the ticket to soldier. I put 6 1 day under Harry Truman, and the males bought me $32 a piece, and the females 20 and 22. It was pretty good money back then. Hip and shearing sheep, it's a crop I fell onto that most of people's overlooked. But if you've got the backbone and grit, it comes every year. Drought or flood, it comes. And it'll pay off if you've got.
You're one of the last sheep shearers, aren't you? In Green County.
That's right. That's what I mean. One that cheered a lot of sheep.
Yeah.
A lot of sheep cheered.
Yeah.
But me and my boys, I have some pretty good sheep cheered. They learn them out. But one year we sheared over 5,000 head right here in Green and adjoining county.
Yeah.
I got the furthest I ever went away from home to shear sheep was Houston, Missouri. No.
Yeah.
A But I got a letter from Jonesboro, Arkansas, this week. And that was just cheaper.
And they put, in 1 week's time, they put 120 some cars.
Maybe now, in Texas?
In Texas. Yeah. And now I've got a friend down there in Texas. He sent me word if I'd bring my dog down there, the coyotes could eat him up. And he wanted 3,000 strychnine capsules. It's against the law, against the law to travel. But he's got 64 sections of land, and he ain't going to let the coyote eat his body. With all coyotes, look here, everything is good for something. Yeah. The meanest man we've got on earth, he's good for something.
Nothing by accident.
That's right. And we can't condemn all coyotes, but they'll all become killers if they get old enough. They got to live. Today, one good thing is these cattlemen have got calf feeders out. Hog feeders have got feeders out. Turkey feeders have got feeders out. They live out of them. So do the peas. They've got to live. Everything, every creature we've got has got to live somewhere or another.
Yeah.
But the commission will show us pictures of the cow, the fox, the hawk, practically every predator. I take them in a wildlife. But still, they say we got to have it. They come this spring. One, my opinion on closing the season on cows. Putting the season on cows. The supervisor. And I told him, just the way it works. I says, here you are. As long as we thought of it. Is the unit, the whole, every state in the union is about cows now. And every state is thought of. But they thought they might interfere with other wildlife breeding habits. But ain't nothing can interfere with that, but nothing.
Yeah. did there used to be wolves, I mean, different, besides coyotes? Was there,
I might have caught one wolf. I was one of the coyotes. At the beginning, I gave a quarter. See, the congregation had one right from the beginning on it, but it's living, nothing like the big one I caught.
Uh-huh.
But my neighbor up here, he had turkeys. And he's getting a turkey, killing his turkeys. And I'd go up there and take him over, I had an old boat dog. She was good. And I'd go up there to kill that cow or wolf back there, and I thought they were wolves. And I couldn't get in a half a mile at him. I knew where he was at. And he'd look around at me this way and that way, and I'd be punking around all day, watching, inspecting his droppings, and found good set for him, great set of traps. But we was a milk. Had a man working for him. I said, "You're gonna finish this milking, I'm gonna go up there and catch him." And I go up there and set a trap on each side of the road. And the next morning I had him. And he's sitting up, he's just sitting down, just like a dog sit. He's big. I had a brand new 36 Chevy. Put a stick in where you crank it, and I hold him all over the country. I wouldn't kill him. I thought he was a dog.
Yeah.
But my hard man killed him. He bat his eyes at me. All the cows that I'd ever caught at that time, when you go up, get so close, they lay down flat on the ground. And I thought he was a dog. Oh, he's big and pretty curls out here.
but what kind was it?
Well, he was blue. No, he was blue. And the first red one I ever caught. As dumb as I am, I thought I turned it loose. I thought he was a dog. So he went out there and looked around at me. I noticed the dogs.
What about bobcats? Did they come back pretty good? Did they ever go?
They've never been up in this part. The closest I know was down in here in South Christian County.
Yeah.
And from the place, I went up to pop the bluff of bobcat hunting. There's lots of them. In other words, the bobcat, the swamp animal. You'll find them out in the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
But well, you want to find bobcats, you go up south across the bluff at Big Island Street. They are there.
Now, of course, along the river, where have you trapped all these years?
I never seen a bobcat's track in Christian or Green County.
What on the river have you trapped?
Oh, I've trapped on the river all my life. The first mink I ever caught was right down there. was just a kid, and I pulled off, I had leather boots. I pulled off them boots, and in there I went at them. Well, you never forget nothing like that. Mm-hmm. And I caught my brother. My mother let me miss the steel. Well, we, I have two brothers, Ross and Bus. They went up here, but they do the chores, and I've done the crafts. And we'd share the money. We bought her boots. One time, Poppy'd give us a team of mules. We'd claim them. We'd bought a lot of mules. We'd break them. Pick out her team, and they'd our team. If he got ready to sell them, he sold them, which he'd sell them about every year. And Ross one year, he bought a new set of gliders. His feet. You know, when he said it right, if he'd ever had his boots or something like that, he just bought him a set of gliders. But it come, I got up bigger, and I had a whole lot of fur, and these two old men come by a barn. You wouldn't help me out, I didn't know. They lived out north of Spring. And they paid me $47 for what fur I had. And I've got that $47, I couldn't put it in my pocket. I had to put it in my hand in my pocket.
You sure stayed there. But what else besides me did you trap? Have you always trapped?
Yeah, I've always trapped. Yes. Even after I got married. You see, I'd keep a boat up to the camp. I had wood boats, all kind of leaking. Mm-hmm. Water soaked, so you couldn't drag them over logs and shoals. I'd keep a boat up in that hole, I'd back it out, and run down Nelson Mill. Mm-hmm. And I'd work the rest of it. And got married. First year I won't get Mr. Harbour. $5.25 a day. And worked the crop. And then furnished everything. Mm-hmm. And got big bottom, right broke down the street there with that park. Mm-hmm. And plowing for 20 acres a week. I broke a young mule every day, and that's pretty hard work. You don't get much done. And rainy days and Sunday days, they work for donations. I moved here in August. I moved over there in August. And I moved here in August, and went to get $400. $416 in this
country. When was this?
That was in 22. And I bought 9 cows. In the marriage, everything the farm with, cultivator, wagon, spring two cars, everything but set of harness. I'd already bought a set of harness. Paid $50 for a new set of harness, second hand. Bought them from an uncle. And way before New Year's, I was down at my uncle's, booking home, and at 2 o'clock I went to Battlefield Bank and paid off. Talked to them cows and the steel rod. It's called the New Year I've met. And it was a great big hit. Man, back in them days, $1.25 a day was, if I wasn't up at 4 o'clock, he hollered, and there's lots of nights I was eating supper at 11 o'clock. That's the kind of day it was. Yeah. But they, during that, now here's what happened. Look at how goes my mother's. I just got my crops out here. My wife had never run a harness team. He's old married again. And I left over there at 2 o'clock and showed her how to unharness the team. I said, just leave the harness in the barn lot. I'll put them up when I get in. It was after dark when I got in. So I go down the creek, up the creek, come down the bank. Run most of the way, but my tips, I got $49 worth of fur. You go from $1 to $40 to $49, you hit it pretty damn hard.
That's right. Well, this wasn't all me. It was beaver, too, wasn't it?
No, I thought, no, there wasn't no beaver back there.
There were?
Oh, you start to get that beaver. I caught 34, fell out and land on the floor. I carried him 3/4 of a mile, and he weighed 50 pounds. You can't carry them on in your arms like that. Yeah. I skinned him and he offered me $2 for him.
So it was all meat then?
Meat,
that was the main bird.
Yeah. Well, I was okay. 12 and a half. You're back when I sold possum for 3 cents. Rabbit for 4 cents. Yeah. But my dog meat bring a 12 and a half.
Yeah.
One year I sold them cheaper. But back then I shipped to St. Louis most of the time. And I shipped to St. Louis. I tried about every third company, and some of them I was still in business. Mays and Stephen, or Mass and Stephen, whatever, I shipped them out of first. And they get skunks. I just grade them out. Get $5 straight for the skunks. And now I wouldn't skin a skunk. They ain't worth it.
Yeah.
Used to when I started trapping, I first skunk I caught, I smelled them. I never smelled another one after cut.
Yeah. I'll be.
Yeah. But Beaver, now 2 years ago, Beaver brought up to $32. Back as a kid, I used to get fur less like Christmas cards. But Beaver, oh my, I just wish I'd get Beaver. And the first thing I plucked, they offered me $2. The best I ever plucked for Beaver was $11. And I sold most of them privately. So I sent them to New York and had them shirts and made them up in the store. Come to these wives down here, got a coat plucked for $200 and she was up at 12 for it.
Well, now, what about you? I always, all my life, I've always heard stories about either it was a panther, or I heard of yacht, maybe possum hunting or coon hunting or something, and the dogs run onto some animal that they really never saw. But what do you think about all of that?
All right, I tell you what, when I work for the government, people is no wild animal in this country will hurt you unless you hear. They get away from you. If you leave them alone, they will not bite you. But when I talk to the government, you often hear that. You hear coyotes can holler a number of different ways, and people don't know it. You've heard coyotes, and maybe don't pat no back at the dog. A coyote can mark any dog, for practically any dog. And any dog will try to mark a coyote, but he can't. That's what it is. And of all the foxes, they don't even know a fox whistles. They do. I didn't know it. I caught 9 fox one evening, right up the bluff here. I heard a man, I caught him as fast as he could bring him in. I went to all the fox hunters, I gave him to the fox hunters. Just went to him and told him, I said, now come down and run tonight. I've got to look out, and there'll be 45 fox down there. And the chickens go down, and that damn other one of them get him a chicken. And you can just kind of put up with that so well.
Yeah.
And some of them come and run, got their dogs rolling. And I went to work that evening, I caught 9 fox. And the next day, I saw one the next day, but he was laying down. And any time, wildlife is about to live. Fox, cows, and coons. There's a young fella lives up here on the, about to say he lives in town, he works for Cross, and he's taking my territory and he's doing good at it. So I pushed him pretty hard. And we were helping this young fella. And I helped him come by here. About here he had 8 coons. And I skinned them. And I opened them up. And all that they had in their stomach was pellet feed.
The barn
rocks. Calf beavers,
yeah.
And hog beavers. Now that's all they have in their stomach.
Well, this isn't good for the wildlife either, is it? I mean, is it okay to live on that? Do you think they live on that?
It's there. If they stayed on it, it would. Now the wildlife eats what they're the most of.
Yeah.
A wildlife, after here you are, it don't make no difference. Pounding sheep or cow, kill free. The meat he eats. They've got to have sweets. Sweets is what makes everybody holler about cold winters. But when pokeberries come, possums and all fur-bearing animals, they go to game. They go downhill after persimmons. Rotten apples are all gone. They've got to have sweets. You take in the West, they destroy watermelons. Cows. Sure, they will here if they don't get sweet, sure. And they think that fur, one winter, the fur may not be as good. when the weather temperature's warm, but cold weather, it might increase itself. But food is what makes everything go into gas. And we quit raising corn, we quit raising grain, or practically a barrel, and cow people out of corn. They made nothing. Up in Will Potter and Wright County, there's an old cripple, another coyote in there, eating oak leaves and acorns.
Never heard of that.
That's right. That's the only place I've ever seen. But you just go out and study them, and study everything. And,
well, who taught you, your dad?
No, I just didn't learn it myself.
Just went out and learned it yourself, yeah. Then.
A weather glass can catch him, and that's what I've told Doug. Doug's argued, but he don't now. He says, if he'd get on to me. And he's a boy. I used to hire him, pay him about an half a day. And then we went to the church. He said, Bunyan Hill, as long as you feel like you can't do a thing, you ain't going to act part of it.
Yeah.
I said, Doug, as long as you feel that way, you ain't going to do good. I said, you've got to make up your mind what you're doing. The secret's a trap. They go on about cows can smell steel and all of that. Smell, they can smell you every day. They can smell good. They don't pay no attention to that. The biggest secret in trapping for anything is get your trap below the level of the ground. Feed up your trap. But just like you, if you're going down a trail and there's a rock there, you step over it. You set that trap. You get down the ground and get that trap below the level of the ground. Don't cover it up. You'll catch something. And you can catch cows there. In other words, I know a guy set a trap on a wild chicken cook. You have no hand to catch hawk. You go to cows. But you've got to change your step. Just blow a twig or something, don't do nothing, they do something to make you step over.
Yeah.
If you just get that trap on top of the ground, he steps over it, he goes around it. Well, he's the hardest thing ever struck the trap. I'd back him as a kid. And I have a number one trap. But they go with the nose right down on the ground, they come out of that hole where you turn that jaw up and throw the trap. Yeah, you flip it up, and now you get on the ferry and throw the crap. Well, he done it a half a dozen or more times, and I couldn't catch him. I think, so there's something wrong. Not get a hair. So I just dug out that hole and put that crap down in there, and let you go in the head.
They went over instead.
Yeah, oh, yeah. He had to go over the trap. He couldn't get his nose on that jump.
You bait your traps, too, don't you?
Oh, no, I believe you. I bait for cows in several different ways. Scent is a good scent if you know. Any time a guy, you go out and try to catch a coyote, and you scent the everything. You don't catch it. And I watch up pretty close. In other words, I change my scent. And that makes a big difference, I think. In other words, I just wouldn't go out and trap coyotes. I would now, for there ain't nobody trying to trap them and catch them. But back when everybody was trapping up in Texas and Wright County, every place they go, they'd have trappers in there, old wood shabby. Buy off of about $20. Give us $20. I mean, a 20, you get $25 above the bounty. And he bet $20. We didn't get a cow with bugs or with traps. And we bust him off. So I'd go over and set my traps. I made three sets. I set for both coyotes, but out of about, they were too many coyotes. And the first night, about a coyote. And she fleeced one all over the court, and she had a big family, Thanksgiving morning. And plus, then coyotes went through that fence, little ones, a brand new fence, golden wire, 32-inch golden wire fence, just like a bunch of kids. Well, we had all the dogs, and we flood of metal. And he wanted to pay for it. No, I said, sorry. One's enough to pay back your dad. Bob Smith with the Conservation Commission, Dodge Cerebral Damage. They feel 75 goat points. One year they got 75 kids goats about every goat year.
What do you scent well? What are some of the things you use to scent a trap with?
Cow's urine. The urine. But I put just a little bit of mint musk in that urine. But most trappers, they want a female and two. That's the Indian season. January and February, but I don't want it back.
Did you have trouble one time with some of that wolf urine you were taking to somebody?
I don't know.
Trouble, but you had a funny situation come up.
Well, I was down here to rest. Somebody wanted to know if it'd come up, and I don't know what he was. I just pulled it out. I could smell of it. That's cool. Here you are. You go out through the country. So where's the strange place? Another trouble for you. Woman stand down with her. She, that's the first thing she'll ask you. What kind of bait do you use?
Yeah.
I just brought the word.
So common even up here, but what I would think of is way up river now, say close to Springfield. But now I've never seen red horse show or anything. Did you ever have that up here?
Not so now. Not before. Now the red, and they show here much earlier than they used to. I say 10 and 15 days earlier than they ever did.
Well,
it's nothing but red horse. There ain't no sucker shows. It used to be a lot of sucker shows here. I sat right down there on a barrel and cut suckers all day long.
Yeah.
Give them the neighbor. And I bring my dinner down and get one every jerk. But now, there's nothing but a few red horse shows up there. But back when I was a kid, there was never not a red horse in Denver.
Well, what did you catch mostly back when you were young?
It was mostly a smallmouth bass.
That was
and barbalite, sure. Yeah.
Well, how did you bait fish then, or did you have artificial lures?
Artificial, what was that old reel? I had one floated away. Now I get $25 for the ticket. I won't say it was terrible, but it was. My God almighty. Just had one little white handle on it. But it was pretty expensive. Back then,
yeah.
Pretty expensive.
Yeah.
But, I've used as a kid that came home. I brought up bigger, about grown, where I went to artificial bait.
Yeah.
The old Thompson, the red Iver fly, up old dive left. Hidden plug, 5 hooks on it. My God.
Well, you grabbed, of course, for sucker and everything.
Oh,
grabbed for everything. What about, did you noodle any?
No. I wouldn't put my hand up near a rattlesnake.
Yeah, that's my sentiments on it. I've watched
same, back on Saturday nights, we'd go sailing, and there was as many as, well, practically every farm, up and down the creek, about 100-foot sink.
Yeah.
And we'd have fish fries. I pulled a burn seine, freeze to death, and back then they seemed they dynamited every little old town. You take places like Nixie, Club, Republic, they blowed up this river before there's any bridges, but up they went to building highways, that stopped it.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, I was down here one night and I heard 11 sticks of dynamite go off.
Well, that wipes it all out, doesn't
it? That's right. And, well, it'd be down there. But they just a bunch of grunts. They come down the creek. Three boats come down the creek. Well, they got out. They all got up, big fight. And it got out. Here comes the game over. And wanted to know. I got on to them. I know the boys, and I got on to them. But one of them, brother, wasn't with them. He told me about it. They only got three fish. Three boats, and they got three fish.
Yeah.
And they come down, and I give them the story. So it was Ray's going to go see him. I said, no, he won't tell him nothing. I said, well, I'll just get him down here. It made me mad. I seen the fish that killed. I said, I'll go get him. And Ray did. He finally got suspicious and settled up. He wouldn't talk. But he said enough that he wasn't the one to buy, and this old boy just gave him the whole story.
Yeah.
Told everything it happened.
What do you think about it? Do you think gigging hurts the river any? Do you think giggers hurt it?
Nope.
I think that's been over-exaggerated, don't you?
Very much.
They can't gig a bass. It's hard to gig a bass. They move so fast.
There's no how and everything.
Yeah.
I've gigged bass. I went up on salt. And the Taylor Ford, right west of Noble Hill, with that old lady, that they murdered.
Yeah, I know exactly where
you are. My first trip up there. And the guy, one of these tailors, we got fishing, and the guy come down. He pulled us into the mast. And we go in, and he said, well, you guys ain't the guys I thought you were. He says, and told me, he says, the guys down here, two hunting, they running, you were up in a big hole of water. And he had to pull it, old steam-drawn motor, he had to pull it up, and he had it locked up, seeing the motor. And he got in the boat, rode down to the lower end of the hole. And we was killing buffalo and suckers the whole lot. And I said something about bass being down there. And his wife was ninja. Before he got ready to leave, he says, you go down there and kill me about 10 bass. 8 or 10 bass, if whatever. And that kind of got me in the spot again. For I think, well, I believe it. I didn't want to, but I just wondering if they begin to talk about talking and getting game fish. But I said, yeah, what do you want to do? Get me in the penitentiary, jail, or something like that? He said, no, it's that's when he come on and said, it's what? It's Corey. He said, I've left her too long now. You run down there and get her 2 days. And I said, if you get me in trouble, it's going to be too bad. It tickled him. I went down and got him the bass.
Yeah.
I know where he's at. I'd go down over the shoulder, pull back up.
Yeah.
That's all it was bass. But, if a bass gets in a light on you, a big bass, you can get a bass, but if there's a guy that'll do anything, they gig them now. In other words, here you are. You remember a year ago this spring when there's some bass come to Springfield, about 25 of them from Stockton Lake, they wouldn't tell what to put them on?
Yeah, I think I remember hearing about that. Think of it.
Ways a guy told me that he's caught in the trammel net.
Well, you know what happened to these fishing contests on the catfish, don't you?
No.
These boys would get down here and have a good night on the trot lines, maybe catch some 30 pound or something, maybe catch 5 or 6 that way. Take them home in a stock pond or the watering tank, and leave them in there, take them in one at a week, you know, and they'd win maybe 5 or 6 weeks straight.
Yeah. Oh, well, I've never entered nothing in the contest. Now other people have. This jackal out here and that bass and that catfish, but I didn't.
Oh, well.
But they turned them in at my name.
Yeah.
But
how big was this catfish here?
He weighed 20 pound 9 ounce.
Where'd you catch it?
Pothole.
Yeah.
And caught him on the nungetter.
Yeah. Well, that was a good fishing hole at one time.
Oh yeah. I caught number. That's the biggest cat, but I've had 2 hung bigger than that.
Yeah. One it's live real now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had one in the Johnson area, and I got him, he's right under the boat. And on his back, when he come off, belly up, and the wrinkles here was longer than a lead pencil.
Oh, okay. What do you think about trout? What's your opinion of these trout?
It's like pond fishing to me. What's this? I was out here at the wash pan. Mickey's baseball school, I can make them bite out there. And if they're fed right, they're good eat. They're sports. But if a commission would put the money in the walleye, bass, and catfish, and do something about the predators in the water, here's gar. You take the gigger, he don't pass a gar. Gigger don't pass a gar or a carp. A seiner. They kill them.
Yeah.
But our river's full of them.
Yeah.
And they back it's a, giving a bull show. The loader, they said the school of the old guard wanted to catch the carp in the bar. They put a lift net down there about before the table rock was completed. And let them do that. If they caught a game fish, turn them back.
Yeah.
It'd be the best thing in the world for our fishing. I went to Worthington. Or so, and looked at the Shroud Moss, the sports show. Herman Roars, Lon Haynes, they never opened their mouth, but Herman Roars got it up every time he mentioned fishing. I was down there and I counted 13 walleye at the Parker 80 that had died. In other words, one had just died, and they was eggs, a circle that deep, they were still running from it. And I thought she was dead. And I picked her up, and said, Herman White, he lived out here by Glasgow. Him and his wife, he'd been down there 2 days and hadn't caught a fish in the Johnson Eddy. And I took it up for her. I said, Herman, she's just as good as she can be. I said, if it wasn't down on the string, you'd eat it. The tide went down and left it. And he dressed it right there on the stump. He was coming home. And darn, he didn't catch another one. Went up the only one he caught went up the
back. Give him that.
Yeah, give him that. And I said, Worthington, why don't you go down there and put some kind of a net or wire across to keep them old fish, Big Jack, from going up there? He said, he couldn't. I said, why can't you? He said, well, they against the law or something like that. I said, my God, it ain't against the law. I says, it's terrible until we, another show. Seen about that minute right there below the dam. The day was bad day. And it comes on, and I told him, I said, if you're drunk, he says, the commission won't let us. He says, it's a gambling deal, and the commission won't gamble for other people's money. I says, it ain't gambling. I says, it's crime. I says, any time that water is enough to wash out a net you put across there, there's water enough for the most female bass, jack, to take care of himself. I says, it's just like your wife or my wife went to the hospital to have a baby. She'll stay there if she has it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Or they stay up there and they can't get back when they put that water on.
Yeah.
And he says it's gambling and they won't gamble with other people's money. And I said, well, if you don't do that, I said, for God's sake, let the people catch them. I says, they'll be allowed to catch them any way they can catch them. He says, you think they ought to open up season right up against the dam like they used to? I says, the way it's going, I says, I'd rather see the people get them as the damn buzzards.
Yeah.
Oh, Herman Rose would bring it up every time. I said, if you're going to do it, if you let me do it, by God, I'll do it myself. And I says, it ain't a fishing now. It's from years to come, and it comes.
Yeah.
But now they're catching quite a few walleye down in the lake.
They moved out of that Johnson Hole and all that, though, didn't they?
Well, they this. That water now, they come up to spawn. People just don't fish for them.
That's what
they just go down there and run to them little white bass.
Yeah.
And I don't know. The water's so doggone clear. There goes a fisherman.
Yeah.
The water's so doggone clear down there at the spring of the year. They just simply don't get up there.
Yeah.
But now I read in the paper where there's a 15-pounder caught down Buck Creek. They took a holler. With your reason.
Of course, they said the smallmouth would never come back in the lake, but they're coming back.
Well, they're down there. Yeah. You ain't kidding. Here you are. Last year ago this spring, we brought in 30 and 27 of them a smallmouth out of Buck Creek.
That's good news.
and good ones.
Yeah.
Yeah. But this spring, it wasn't so good. One evening, I caught my limit down there, and he was 8 for smallmouth and 2 line size. I kept many more smallmouth for the last 2 years down there. We do.
Do you think they know what they're doing about stocking and everything?
No, I don't.
I know you read articles, a bunch of boys from college will go down and study a fish and then write an article on it.
All our conservation commission is, the way I see it, with some good writers and BSers. They don't know nothing about wildlife.
Right.
I just, I hate to say it, the supervisor, these ashes he dumped up there, he's the one asked me about the season on the coyote. And he come and told me about it. I seen it on television. Wanted to go up and look at it, which I did. It's unbelievable. I've noticed it down here. The gravel is just as black, goddamn, as he.
That's terrible.
And, but says it didn't kill no fish. They never found a dead fish. I says, there ain't no fish to kill.
Yeah.
I says, it maybe won't kill fish. I don't know. But I says, the problem, there ain't no fish. I says, you've got these electric nets. The proof to you, I says, I know the hole that's got fish in it. For sure, there's fish in it. Anywhere you want to go, I says, I've got boats, I've got motors, I've got waders. I says, let's just sand some of these holes and see what we get out of it. They never brought none of them nets yet. You take a back in the lake in by the lake, custom, they say they're just the same in that lake constantly. They keep them running from the bank, they claim, them lake
yeah.
nets.
Yeah.
And they, picking the scales off of them, the like of that, why, it's silly.
Where'd you go to school?
What little I had is over here at Hartley School.
Where was Hartley School?
It's right over here, a little old schoolhouse sits over there now, it's about as big as this room. Don Disease Kid calls it my school.
Well, Don, you lived pretty much within an area around your own school or church, then,
yeah,
didn't you?
Yeah.
You didn't go running all over the country.
No, that's
there.
Right. I've been here all my life, and I'm here about all the time now.
Yeah.
I'll probably be here any time you come. If you wait, I'll be there before dark comes. I'll tell you, a lot of people, I've got a daughter, they struck out to Canada this morning. And I wouldn't get on an airplane, never, unless it's a half-two ticket out. And my brother,
I've been
in a number of states. I've been in Old Mexico, I've been in Canada, and I can't find no place better than right around
here. That's right, that's exactly
right. I can get in my truck and drive this way a half a day and come in and be happy.
Yeah.
Any direction I go, I do it ever so often. And you see a
what did you do when you were growing up for entertainment? Did you have church socials or school socials?
I know. All we had was dances.
Square dancing,
Square dancing, yeah. I rode a horse and buggy called Ebenezer.
Ebenezer?
Ebenezer. Both of us are sound asleep. Coming right down the commercial street, and the streetcar woke the old horse bring us home. Streetcar woke us up. The sun was up just about that high.
Were they ground dancing then, or square dancing?
No.
No ground dancing, was
it? Well, it began when I was quitting, it began.
Did you still have a lot of jiggers then?
Oh, yeah. We had some big black horseshoe pickles, too.
Yeah.
That's my game, sporty games to play is marbles and pitching horses.
Yeah, marbles, really? There were a lot of men play marbles, didn't
they? I just had to use that thumbnail. Never played for kids. We played for fun.
Yeah.
And we got to playing for kids. All the ball playing they ever done, we make our own balls.
Yeah.
My mother has thrashed me many times for cutting a good sock up to make a ball. See, a sock will unravel. You can just unravel it and make your ball.
Took care of most of your own problems, didn't you?
Yeah.
You go running to the lawyer, to the police every time something went wrong.
And every time you run to them lawyers, it takes money.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
What about this place over here, Union Ridge Church? I always hear a lot about it.
Union Ridge?
Yeah.
Bloody
Ridge is what I heard it called mainly. Over there by Hoot Town, isn't it?
Well, I never did get down that
place over there.
Yeah, I never did get down that first. Oh, look back when I was a kid, here you are, it's every church and every school is, as I say, there's a rotten apple in every barrel.
Oh, yeah. And it was the only place people really gathered.
Yeah.
There
was always some boys had a grudge against them boys, but now, my family never was that way.
Yeah.
Way back before I was married, I went to go down here to see Pete Church. But there was a little girl down there. Boys coming up, better not go down there. Boy, they're tough. Why, heck, boy, I never had boys to like me.
Yeah.
I tell you what, I've never had a fight in my life. Only two.
Yeah.
Never had an argument, you might say. Only among kidding folks.
Yeah. Well, everybody has that. Well, when you, of course, you were on the river all the time and everything, you fished, but when did guiding, when did you first start seeing people pay to go fishing?
Well, guiding was a whole lot like sheep shearing. I just got to, well, I say Cotton Harris is the main one. Now, he used to come out and sing with us. And we got to coming, we got to fishing. I'd go down here and done it. I went and hit the Blue Springs Bridge, me and my brother. The family and neighbors go down the Blue Springs Bridge, show you the pictures of it. Not have a fish, don't have a fish fry. And we'd start right down the river. We'd go down to Blue Springs. We'd have enough fish to have and catch them on a rod, an old Oxford rod, and a cheap reel. But he'd take one bank, me the other. Both of us knowed how to catch soft crawdads. Now you can't catch crawdads. And if there's a few big ones by man, but for them big old green ones. And you turn over every rock. Well, Jack Lilly, 2 or 3 years ago, when he was working down here, he come down here and stopped, and he says, Homer, I've got a question I want to ask you. He said, tell me why that above Springfield Lake, James River's little old bass out along, it's just full. Why ain't there none down along here? I said, it's a damn powerhouse, don't you know? I says, any stream we've got, here you are, any stream we've got crawdads in, you've got meat, and you've got smallmouth bass, and you can't catch them all out. You can sing it every day, and they'll always be bass, and they'll always be meat. And Wilson Creek, I've got a lot of bass out of Wilson Creek.
Hard for me to believe.
Well, it says, not many up. After Table Rock Lake, they family back up here, you know. And they want that belt for lake, and they want to stop. And I said, you don't know where they get the bass. Or anywhere. We went over there to Hazeltine Road with a 15-foot minnow center. And we had 4 milk there. And we made, well, it's about 4 trips. And we put 20 or 30 to a camp. There ain't just as many bass there, I'd just run across and dip up them bass out along there. We filled our pond full. I believe it was 30. And we had, that'd be 120. And we made 4 trips.
Oh my gosh. 480.
That's right.
So when did you start guiding for a business then? Or as a business? When did you start, you know, I remember when they started, it started as a business, you know. I mean, people always fish together.
I started with one boat. And then I got up to 3. And
you were just working this upper part of James,
right? Well, I floated.
Down to what would you go over?
I floated White River a lot.
Yeah.
From Biola, talking to Bryce Lipscomb. And I'll show you pictures. I told him, I said, maybe I'll mention your name, but there's a guy coming out here tonight for an interview. Yep, there ain't many of them left. They just about all gone. What year it was, I don't have the least idea.
30s probably, early 30s?
Well, yeah, I think it was back in the 30s, I'd say. In other words, I had an old wood boat, green boat, and boy, I don't know how in the world I ever done it. I'd go from here to Mouth of Finland. Even in the wintertime, old Op McCrum, for years, he kept me engaged from this year, next year, he engaged me opening day and every Sunday and holiday till I got further notice. It was just every year. And the Cotton Harris, he got the float, and he got the bringing guy. And then I get this, or a truck, here you are. I take them out to $5 and tell a truck to help me, pay $3 of it for truck to home.
Yeah.
But $2 a day, pretty good job.
Yeah.
But pretty darn hard.
Yeah. Did you have some other guys that worked for you here?
Not them.
Yeah.
I might have somebody working on the place. And I have.
You were about the only one that got at this part right in here.
Yeah, they come up here at least.
Did you mention you worked for down at Branson?
I worked for Hope down there, son.
Yeah.
Out of O.J. Dock at Mount Swan. And Hope said, I brought you down there. I said, I tell you, I've taken the old man Greenway's his neighbor. Oh, three or four. Well, while Hope was down there, I've come in there from fishing. I've been up Prado and haven't done no good. And Hope says, hey, Comer, I've guided several trucks. And I've guided several guys. Don Evans, he wouldn't go with the Rotary Club. He comes and says, Comer, I've guided him a lot here on Gambry. He says, I'm going to all go down there. And he says, I want you to go guide for me. He says, the main thing is keep me from getting drunk.
Have you ever had any funny experiences you can think of with patrons that were, either got a little too much or did things happen that you can remember?
I was out with one man that got drunk, and he was a doctor. He was drunk. When we got to the mouth of Finley, we was on a three-day float trip. And he was drunk. His name was, he was
dead.
He's dead and gone.
Yeah.
And then there was six boats of us put in here at Camel Street Bridge. Three from Green. Purple. Charlie Barnes was good and daddy.
Mm-hmm.
And I said three, there were six boats. And the seventh one was putting in at Green on Saturday. Saturday night. And, here comes the office ring. Hit the river was up 4 feet. The women got pretty drunk. It's kind of funny. They all had tents, lots of booze. And, next morning, we stayed right down here below Nelson Mill the first night. And we eat dinner right down here. And at noon, it rained, my God, our boat full of water. And it rained that night, and the next morning that river, it was a sight. And the guy says, what do we do? I says, we'll quit. And he says, these people come in here from Chicago and they want to fish. Well, I says, the only thing I know is for you to strike out the right river, or go purple. I says, I'll tell you what you do. You go talk to Charlie. Charlie Barnes, he's an old guy.
Yeah.
They paid him $5 extra a day for the cook. So you go talk to Charlie. Charlie told him just like I did. Well, here they come. They went and called, went to the phone, called, and come pick them up. On what was in. He went and load them on down further. Didn't rain down there, the river wasn't muddy. They come to me and I says, it ain't. But I says, it will be in the morning. I says, we'll be right in the same old boat. I says, we're just blowed. I says, you go to Charlie now. You go ask Charlie. And he went to Charlie and Charlie come to me and he says, I don't know why in the hell they want to do that, the money that man spends with them. He's going to catch on. Back then in Bull Creek, fishing, crappie fishing was good. And I told him, I said, you might catch some fish. Bull Creek don't come in, maybe go down there and maybe have a good trip. They just, that guy swept out back to the cars. I blew their cars this year. And the guy, the commissary was the truck. Had a big truck, and it was a promissory.
Yeah.
He cleaned up behind us. And we was a day flattening it out, driving in to camp. It's a heck of a trip. And they stepped out down there, and they put the office bunch of coffee, and then people by the time they had
to come. They'd gone to where they didn't even They were using the truck for the commissary instead of the commissary boat.
Yeah, you should be using the truck.
It really got developed, didn't it?
Oh, sure, yeah. See, we got to go fishing.
Yeah.
A purple and him, man, taking care of the commissary and everything.
Well,
that morning was all waiting. One of these old gals come out of the tent, she's pretty, I think, a pretty good old gal. She says, you know, them women beats any women I ever saw in my life. They have Scott's liquor in the truck. We picked it up here to Lemon Lord to a cabin. I had a whole case of liquor for us back. This old gal says, you know, them the beatenest women I ever saw in my life. She says, I drink that stuff to keep from getting sick. And it just made me sick as a horse, and he drank a good lot of water, and it didn't bother him.
Who were some of the guides you knew that were guided, you know, for money, or professionally, like they did there?
Oh, these Charlie Barnes, and...
Now, he was from Galena, wasn't he?
He was from Galena. And the only guide that I ever heard in my life in this part of the country was Albert Cornett. And he guided for Jim Owens and for himself. He's in down there where I got acquainted with him. He's down there at Mills Ferry. It's a K-Bout now.
He lived down around Forsyth?
He lived in Branson.
In Branson, uh-huh.
And down in K-Bout. And he finally went down in Arkansas. He died down there. And he was a fisherman, a turkey hunter, a quail hunter. I used to turkey. You could kill turkey. You could kill deer. We'd go down there. Once we was down there a couple of 3 days, and we had Albert Hard. And that evening, he says, I've got to go down on that Greer's Ranch there. He says, I've got to go down and see about the deer. They eat now 5 foot. And told him to shoot him. And he was a panning to shoot him. Old boy's with me. He lives up here. He's about 85 years old now, west of Springfield. He says, you know, I'd get $10 for a deer. Brother mine went with him. He says, you want to go home? I said, no, you ain't going to get me in jail. This is way before the conversation.
Yeah.
They go. There wasn't no deer showed up. But the day after we come home, why, any boy looked there for deer.
Pretty